Hi, I'm Manuela Battaglia, an immunologist at the Diabetes Research Institute of Milano at the San Raffaele Hospital, Italy. In this brief video, we describe the data that we recently published in JCI Insight on the role of neutrophils in type 1 diabetes. Type 1 diabetes is a chronic disease that is caused by the lack of endogenous insulin production. The clinical manifestation of type 1 diabetes occurs both at young and adult age. So type 1 diabetes is nowadays considered a disease at stages. And we have, of course, a genetic predisposition that poses subjects at risk to become diabetic. And then an immune activation that the causes are still unknown. The beta cells are attacked and the immune response starts to develop. So type 1 diabetes really starts in what is called today stage 1, where subjects have normal blood sugar, no clinical symptoms, but they have at least two or more diabetes-related autoantibodies. These subjects might then enter in stage 2, where they have abnormal blood sugar and more than two antibodies, and then enter in stage 3 with clinical diagnosis, and stage 4 is a long-standing disease. There are now several evidence, both in animal models and in humans, that really demonstrate that T lymphocytes play a key role. However, this might not be the complete picture, and the work we just published in JCI Insight is really an attempt to enlarge our focused vision on type 1D pathogenesis. 5 years ago, a brilliant PhD student in my lab at that time, Andrea Valle, observed that patients with type 1 diabetes have reduced number of circulating neutrophils. And moreover, we observed that subjects at early stage of the disease, so before clinical manifestation at stage 1 and 2, also had low neutrophil counts. And the higher the risk to develop type 1 diabetes, the lower is the neutrophil counts. In addition, we show that neutrophils infiltrate the pancreas of 3 organ donors with type 1 diabetes. And the earlier the clinical manifestation, the higher the number of neutrophils marginalized in the pancreas. These findings were published 5 years ago and were confirmed also by independent labs that really confirm that reduced neutrophil counts is a hallmark of type 1 diabetes. I decided, together with my lab, to switch the focus of my research from T lymphocytes and their role in type 1 diabetes to neutrophils, basically for 3 reasons. First, because many other autoimmune diseases like lupus, rheumatoid arthritis, vasculitis, have been shown to have neutrophils as a key player in their pathogenesis in humans. So I thought that maybe this could also occur in type 1 diabetes, although none of the investigators really focused their research on this topic. And the second reason was that Agnès Louen from Paris published a few weeks after we demonstrated the reduced number of neutrophils in patients with type 1 diabetes, that also neutrophils have a key role in an animal model of autoimmune diabetes, the NOD mice. This paper was really crucial for us to decide that maybe neutrophils might really play a role in type 1 diabetes. And the third reason was that I thought at that time that the field of type 1 diabetes was stuck and focused too much on the role of a single cell subset. And I thought it was time to give a fresh air to the lab and maybe also to the field. Therefore, we decided to challenge the hypothesis that neutrophils play a role in type 1 diabetes pathogenesis in humans. The first question we had was to try to understand whether the number of circulating neutrophils is somehow correlated to pancreatic function. We were able to address these questions thanks to the fact that we are part of a very important network in type 1 diabetes, which is TrialNet. Thanks to the data we collected at international sites and also at our local TrialNet clinical center, we were able to analyze almost 600 measurements originated from subjects of stage 1 and 2 of type 1 diabetes. And these data were also confirmed when we consider important confounding factors such as age, gender, and BMI. This careful statistical analysis confirmed that the lower the neutrophil counts in the periphery, the worse the beta cell function. We were able to confirm that neutrophils infiltrate pancreas of donors with type 1 diabetes, but also that neutrophils are found increased in the pancreas of subjects autoantibody positive. And this was possible thanks to our collaboration with NPOD.
NPOD stands for the Network for Pancreatic Organ Donors with Diabetes, and it's a large initiative based in the United States in terms of organ donors, where pancreases are procured, processed, and subject to research in diabetes. We currently have about 500 cases in the biobank, and they're supporting about 230 projects in 20 countries around the world. And one of the greatest contributions I think that NPOD has made has been to challenge these longstanding dogmas and really help to improve our understanding of the natural history of diabetes. The hope is that this new and emerging information will lead to better ways to diagnose the disease, understand why the disorder develops, and ultimately lead to ways to prevent and or cure it.
In addition to NPOD, we collaborated also with the DIVID study, with Exeter, and with Siena. Three very important locally collected cohorts of subjects with type 1 diabetes.
Well, we're fortunate to curate the Exeter Archival Diabetes Biobank, which is a collection of samples of autopsy pancreas, came from people who died very soon after receiving a diagnosis of type 1 diabetes. And they were collected in the 1980s, so they're a historical collection. We've been able to contribute to the work by sharing samples from that collection, a total of 6 in this case. Because of the way the material is harvested, they're not always ideal for immunostaining, but nonetheless, we were able to use them to confirm the presence of infiltrating neutrophils after a diagnosis of type 1 diabetes.
Both NPOD and Exeter collect pancreas from organ donors, and this is a limitation of all these studies. That's why we collaborated with the group of Knut Dahl Jorgensen in Oslo, who conducted the DIVID study. So Lars, can you please tell us in few words what is exactly the DIVID study?
The DIVID study is a collection of pancreatic tissue from newly diagnosed adult live patients that we collected in the years 2011 to 2013. And what's special with this cohort is that every patient, besides being live, also the pancreatic material was collected straight after the diagnosis was established, in average 5 weeks after the diagnosis of type 1 diabetes was established. So that means that these samples are from really newly diagnosed type 1 diabetic patients, representing the situation in pancreas just at the moment of the disease onset.
So another key collaborator that was really fundamental for our original paper, but also in this new one, is the group of Francesco Dotta in Siena. So not only they made available a new donor from their cohort, but they significantly contributed to the histological analysis of neutrophils infiltrating the pancreas.
We observed neutrophils in the pancreas with an abnormal shape, and we also obtained additional proof of tissue residing netting neutrophils by the identification of the condensed DNA decorated with NPO and citrullinated isons, as you can see from this representative image from a section of the DIVID study. In this video, you can appreciate a pancreas-infiltrating neutrophils from a DIVID donor that is clearly releasing NETs. You can see in white DNA, in green NPO, and in red citrullinated histone.
Yeah, I think this is extremely interesting, as enhanced NET formation and reduced NET clearance may contribute to immunogenicity, as it was shown in other autoimmune diseases such as lupus and rheumatoid arthritis. We generated additional data that are really intriguing, and this is about the localization of neutrophils in the pancreas.
As you can see here, we confirm our original findings that neutrophils are not specifically localized around the pancreas, as one would imagine in a beta-cell-specific disease such as type 1 diabetes, but can be found scattered in the whole pancreas, in the vessels, within the exocrine tissue, and sometimes in the so-called insulites, the immune cells that infiltrate the pancreatic islets.
Finally, to test whether pathogenic neutrophils migrate and infiltrate the pancreas or remain in the circulation, we decided to purify neutrophils from the blood of kids with type 1 diabetes, kids at risk to become diabetic enrolled in our local trial cohort, and healthy kids. These purified neutrophils were then used to generate RNA sequencing data. As in modern science, we generate a lot of big data, it is also very important to collaborate with investigators who are used to manage big data and are able to analyze properly this information. To do so, we collaborated with Peter Linsley and Matthew Dufort from the BRI in Seattle.
So we compare the gene expression between these four different subject groups, and what we see is that there is a group of genes that are highly expressed in the type 1 diabetic subjects, the autoantibody positive relatives, and the autoantibody negative relatives, and not highly expressed in the non-diabetic controls. There are about 300 genes that show up differentiating these two sort of groups, and it's important to note that we didn't go in looking at these in this comparison. We did not start out comparing the non-diabetics to all the other subjects. We started out comparing these four groups, and these are the genes that showed up as being different among all of those groups. And they unite both the type 1 diabetics, the autoantibody positives, and the relatives who don't yet have any diabetes-related autoantibodies. So the peripheral neutrophils already have this distinct transcriptomic signature prior to seroconversion to autoantibody positivity. And when we look at what those genes actually are, using functional enrichment of the gene ontology terms, we see that there are a number of genes related to response to interferon. This is both type 1 and type 2 interferons, interferon alpha and interferon gamma. And those genes as a set are more highly expressed in the new onset type 1 diabetics and in the at-risk subjects, both the autoantibody negatives and the autoantibody positives, than they are in the unrelated controls. Focusing on those genes, how their expression varies among the non-diabetic controls and these three risk groups. And what this tells us is that there's something different about the neutrophils already in those subjects prior to seroconversion. What this suggests to us is that there's something different about the neutrophils in those subjects even prior to seroconversion, which is probably related to genetic background.
These findings is that interferon genes have been implicated in type 1 diabetes for a long time. And this gives us new insight into how the genes are expressed in first degree relatives versus healthy controls.
So overall, our new data suggests that neutrophils might indeed play a role in type 1 diabetes, might be linked to pancreas function, have a unique signature in their periphery, and infiltrate the pancreas, where they can also extrude NETs that might play an important pathogenic role in type 1 diabetes. We think these data can provide a new view on the pathogenesis of type 1 diabetes, and therefore suggest maybe new ways of preventing or curing a disease that nowadays is still incurable.